Brilliant.
Right, Aki Karime, BBTV. I am here with Clifton Mitchell. Firstly, you were doing some security duties up there. Obviously, you run the security firm, but when you have a big fight like this, and it's quite tense, and it's been a tense press conference, what's going through your mind when you actually have to marshal one of these events?
More to the point of, I think it's just to do with making sure punches ain't thrown, or slaps ain't thrown, or pushing and shoving is not too bad, but as soon as hands start coming out, you could get a cut, understand? And the fight's off, isn't it? Understand? Just slightest things like that. And it's not in the interest of boxing, is it? That type of one, so I'm gonna just get rid of this person. It's not in the interest of boxing, so bringing the game into disrepute is the word.
Well, fair enough. Although he went
smooth. Yeah, I knew it goes smooth. Yeah. You got two gentlemen up there, or two professionals. That unless somebody's really said something out of order up there. I mean, it was a bit tasty yesterday, but listen, it's boxing. We're talking about two. You've got one kid that's very privately educated. You've got one kid that's straight off the road, isn't it? So you're gonna get the clash, aren't you? You are going to get the clash.
It's had a bit of backlash at the press conference from yesterday. But
no, I think it's a load of rubbish.
Yeah, go on. Tell me why you think that.
Because nobody really said anything. He says, basically, one asked him about his sexuality, the other one said that he was cheating. Yeah, that he was cheating. So, really, just really nothing, is it? You know what I mean? One second. Yeah. Hello? Yeah, 6822. Right, bye.
That's not your PIN number, Clifton.
It is.
Is it?
Yeah.
Right.
That's why you get rang me back.
Come to edit that out.
Yeah, you need to find my PIN first, mate.
Clifton, you know when back in the days when you was fighting, when you had a bit of a needle in between someone, did it throw you off the game? Because I know you was quite hot-headed at times.
Yeah, but most of this is all camaraderie. It's all, a lot of it's, I mean, it's not always like that, but sometimes people do go on your back. And basically, you wind yourself up rather than somebody else winds you up, because it's somebody else, you're only winding yourself up. So you need self. This is the time where people burst a bubble before the fight. So these have been in the game long enough to know how to control their emotions. Especially every time you have an endorphin rush, you're taking something off you, aren't you? Mm-hmm. You know, so try your best to, you know. Naz was the best at it. He used to say everything in tongue and cheek. If you're saying tongue and cheek and don't take nothing too serious, at the end of the day, when you get in that boxing ring tomorrow, if you're carrying any emotions in there, it's hard, it's harder. It's going to be harder for you. Understand? So you just need to be, get in there, level-headed, treat it like a open sparring match rather than a fight. Because once you start putting labels on it, that's the time then you're more likely to fight harder than you need to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah? Mm-hmm. I get you. Now, a lot of people I've been speaking to, you know, doing some build up to this, they actually were tipping Liam Smith to win. You're not saying you're going for Eubank. Can you tell me why you're going for Eubank and your particular reasons for that?
I think that Eubank's. I think, okay, if you give them all round attributes, I'd say Liam Smith's got more. Beef has got more. But I just think that Eubanks has got that offsetting style that offsets you, and it also, it always seems to find his way through. Always seems to find his way through. I'm not saying that Liam's not good enough to win. I just think it's a very, very close fight. But if I had to put money on one of them, I'm going to go with Eubanks. I think he's a bit fresher. I think he's bigger. And I think he's tougher.
Do you think he missed out on an opportunity because after the Conor Ben saga, he was actually a bit of a hero in the public eye?
But you know what I'm trying to say to you? He doesn't want that.
He doesn't want it, does he? Yeah.
He doesn't want that. He doesn't want it because he gets more fun out of mating him than loving him. It's too early. It's too early for him to love him. He wants everyone to love him at the end of his career, not off in the middle of it. You know. So I think I don't want that out yet. You know what I mean? Because he come out there smelling the roses, and then what's happened? I don't want them roses, mate. You know what I mean? I want everybody to hate me still.
He's really grown on me, to be honest. In the last few months. You know, tomorrow it's going to be a moody atmosphere in Manchester.
Yeah.
You've got a lot of scouts coming. You've got probably from down south coming. Mm. You again as running a security operation. Mm. What's going through your mind for tomorrow night?
Well, what I'm thinking is tomorrow we need to keep this. It's not just us; it's the arena security as well. So, you know, we only look after the inner ring side and backstage. Mm-hmm. So it's all we can. What's it called?
I don't think the PIN number worked.
No, somebody else. So that's all we can control. So as long as we can control our bits, if we need to help outside the ring, we will. But I mean, we've got this locked off. So as long as we lock off this, and we're all working in the same, on the same hymn sheet, on the same page, on the same line, and then we're good to go, you know.
All right, I get you. So
listen, we've done big shows, we do big shows all the time. We did Wembley, so Wembley Stadium, we had the whole floor at Wembley, the stadium, not the arena, you know what I mean.
Yeah,
so we've done big shows, and we've done a lot of high class events, or let's say, pay-per-view events. There's a lot of pay-per-view events, so it's good. It's good work, and it's good for us. And I'm blessed to be in this position, and I'm blessed to have this contract. So I take nothing for granted, but also we're good at what we do. So we would not be doing it for 20 odd years if we didn't know what we were doing.
Well, people coming to Manchester tomorrow for the fight. Don't worry, you're in good hands. Clifton says.
Yeah. We don't run off. So we don't run. We stand. We don't run. At the end of the day, you know, I'd rather. I would rather. Say, oh, Clifton got absolutely battered at this show. Then I saw Clifton running down the fucking, running away. Understand? Because that's where that's because it's my company. If I'm not standing, if I'm not going to stand and back it, I don't care. Who's going to back it for me? If you can't back your own, who's going to back it for you? And so I don't expect my staff to stand if I'm running. Leave it at that, then.
I'm going to change tack slightly just for the last question, Clifton. I know you were obviously, you went out with Tyson Fury when you fought Cunningham. Yeah. You were in the corner.
Yeah.
You were a former member of the team. I know you're still loyal and close to the team anyway. There's all this going on at the minute, saga. Will it happen? Will it not happen with Usyk? Is it going to happen, Clifton?
I think it's got to happen. I think it's got to happen. I think it's got to happen because you have to. It's too juicy not for it to happen, isn't it? Come on, let's get it right. I think it's too juicy, and everything. So it's going to be like Evander Holyfield against Riddick Bowe, that type of fight. Yeah, but I think. The problem with Usyk is, he punches hard enough. He does punch hard enough, but does he punch hard enough? Not really. Not really, because he didn't take Joshua out, and he was hitting Joshua with a big shot. So, you know, them fighters that are tough, fit, and strong, they're the fighters that you have to worry about. I say, Joe Joyce, world class chin, yeah? And tough and fit and ready to go. So he is a problem for anybody. Anybody. He's probably the most dangerous one out of the lot of them, aren't there? I think he's probably one of the most dangerous ones out there. Out of all of them to fight, he's got to be the bogeyman. He's the George Foreman of the division, isn't he?
Yeah. But it sounds like you're back in Tyson to do the job on Usyk if it happens.
Yeah, I think the problem is Usyk only can box one way. But Tyson can switch it up. He can box longer and think, you know what, I'm going to jump on you and I'm just going to stay on you like a fucking rash. Understand? And then just start just bashing him up. And the thing is, yeah, if you box Usyk and you've got no feet, you've got no movement, then you're struggling. And that's a problem that Joshua had. Understand? That was a problem Joshua had because he couldn't cut the ring off, even though he did better the second time. Maybe if he boxed me, then he'd do better. But, you know, the kid's just too clever for him. Joshua started at 19, this kid's top age started at 9. And in football terms, if somebody starts playing football at 19 and somebody's been playing football since they've been 3 and 4 and 5, you know, they've got a hell of a lot of experience. It's like, as good as you are playing American football in this country, if you go to America, you wouldn't even make, you know what I mean, the second team, you know what I'm saying to you? Because it's something that's naturally done. Like basketball is as well, you know. Very rarely, there's an odd basketball player that comes from England or comes from Europe that can play in the NBA. The odd one. But all in all, I just think that pedigree is the king, I think. I think Joshua has done absolutely wonders for British boxing. He's the man that's carried this sport to the next level. I do believe that. Since he came on the scene, and Matchroom, could I give them the shout as well? They've bought it up, but boxers taking the mantle, I think, now.
Yeah, they're doing well, they're certainly pushing on, aren't they?
Look at, have you seen a stage like that?
Yeah.
in boxing. Oh, in this country. I've not seen a stage like that in boxing since in all the years I've been boxing. You'd have thought you was in America. That type of stage.
Yeah. They are doing a great job.
Yeah, they're not playing at it.
Fights that we want to see as boxing.
Forget dressing it up. Good fights on the bill. Congo, Echo. Yeah? Who do you think wins that?
I'd probably edge towards Congo, but I like them both. That's probably just a bit more technical skills on Congo. I know Westman's from now Nottingham, from Arnica, the world's book.
I think all depends how much Congo's. I mean, Essamon's got left in his legs, yeah. And I think Echo's a lot more trickier than people actually think he is. He's harder to hit than what you think he is. Understand? Mm-hmm. And I think Congo looks sharp, and he's just trying to hit you with that big right hand all the time, isn't he? So, and I think if he works that out. But one thing, that's a good fight to watch. The winner should box my fight, Harry Scarf. You know I was going to bring him. Horrible Harry Scarf. Nobody wants him. Nobody wants a piece of him. So, therefore, we just have to keep plugging away. We will get a shot eventually. If Echo wins, we won't get a shot. If Congo wins, we might get a shot. You never know.
All right. In that case, then, we'll have to root for Congo.
I can't.
Good fight, though.
I can't. Even though he's a Forest fan. I'm still going to go for East Midlands boy.
Fair play to you.
Yeah, cool. Just plus because Congo don't want to fight Harry, so I'll go with Exo.
It's always good getting your take on things at the big fights. We'll catch up with you tomorrow after some big reaction after all the fights.
Okay, nice one. See you again. See you tomorrow. Bye bye.